בוקר טוב לכולם. אני שמח לראות אתכם כאן שוב לאחר היום המוצלח, ככה אני שומע שהיה לנו אתמול.
I thought that it was a very interesting day and a very important one. We have a very long day ahead of us.
מרוכז.
Very intense day. That we are going to begin with a lecture by the head of the IDE, the IDI. I would like to make some points about today, the conference today. The structure is similar to what the original program, other than the lecture by the chief of staff, which we heard yesterday. The only change is to the program tonight, our concluding session that will begin at 6:45 p.m. We will be honored to hear three very important, very distinguished speakers: the governor of the Bank of Israel, Stanley Fischer. We will then hear the Minister of Justice, Tzipi Livni, and if everything goes as planned, we will hear the Minister of Finance, Yair Lapid. He will be our final speaker. And the conference will be concluded by the head of the INSS, Amos Yadlin. We hope that the program will proceed as planned, and we hope that you have an interesting day. I would like to invite the head of the research division in the IDI, Brigade General Itai Brun, who will present his perspective of the Middle East in an era of global permutations and regional turmoil. As the chief of staff said yesterday, we will certainly hear a very interesting lecture, a very important lecture, as it will be an important opening to our conference today. Good morning. Israel's strategic environment is influenced by three developments that are occurring in parallel. These are significant changes in the international arena. The second is what we call the regional turmoil, what is usually known as the Arab Spring, and the fundamental changes, ongoing changes in the operative environment. I am going to discuss these three developments, specifically the second. A few words about the international system. The international system, as we have known it for decades, is changing. The international economy is unstable as a result of uncertainty in Europe and financial problems in the United States. The other components, so there are new players there in the financial world. There is the BRICS that describes how other financial players have become more powerful. We will emphasize the developments in Shanghai. It is a new world in which the international system is dominated by the Americans, but not as it was in the past. The international arena would prefer to deal with other issues, such as the issues in South Korea, as you can see on the screen. The international world is always drawn to the Middle East, and we see its influence as limited. It is deterred by long-term commitments and is hesitant to take on to make conclusive decisions. This is an example of the limited capabilities of the international arena. The supervisors in Syria that concluded their responsibility without any significant achievements, and then again we have the superpowers who are holding debates with Iran but have not reached any conclusions. the regional turmoil that in our region we have considered since 2011. It is transforming from the previous environment that is not that is disappearing. It is the current situation is one of instability. I think instability is an uncertainty describes the situation in our region. From the limited perspective of the past 2 years, we can see significant changes to the regional architecture and new groups, new camps, and potentially new boundaries and identities and social identities. These three pictures have become, to a certain extent, icons of the past year. We have Mubarak in a cage, and Salah Hussein was signing an agreement to leave his position. If these are the three icons, the three visual icons of 2011, I think that this is the picture that can be the icon of 2012, the regional turmoil that began with the end of the old regime and the increase in the voice of the people, which was emphasized by the rise in the Islamic rise. The victory was a result of long-term groundwork. The Islamic movements were victorious in Syria and in Egypt, and they affected Turkey and the Palestinian Authority. They certainly enjoyed the fruits of the revolution. The victory of the Islamic movements has increased the contribution, the significance of the religious ideology of the, which is anti-Israel and objects to its existence. We should not expect this to change. The Muslim Brothers have been pragmatic about the changes that they expect to occur. The Muslim Brothers is not a global movement that is directed by some hidden or in leadership, but we can talk about what appears to be an increase in the power of those Islamic movements. We saw proof of their first example of their power in Gaza and in other regions. This region is hostile towards Israel. The deliberations in this area, in this respect, talks often about the influence of Qatar and the media manipulations and its ability to influence events very significantly. So there are demands for reforms and the Iranian threat. This is not a good time for Iran. The radical axis is fighting. The Syrian regime has collapsed, and the Hamas has moved from the radical axis to the Hasisugi camp, and the voice of the people has become more powerful. This axis is, of course, fights specifically in Syria, and we'll talk about that later. The public is very active, very volatile in all areas, in Egypt, in Syria, in Tunis, in Libya, and in many other places. The attempt to translate their power to political capital failed, and Arab politics is still dominated by members of the old politicians. These communities demand changes now immediately, and the leadership has to handle financial crisis that is really no solution for, which is similar to the Ricky Cohen example of metaphor from Hadera. The demands are financial problems are increasing. We have to the regimes are more attentive to the demands of the people, which is a positive development. Another phenomenon that is very clear is the threat of the international of the world's jihad. Here we have two different topics that arise. One is that Bin Laden was replaced. The agenda is more regional, more focused on Israel, and there is difficulty in ruling different areas in the Middle East that increase the direct threat on Israel. The worldwide jihad is focusing more on the state of Israel. As we see here on the left, there's a picture of the world jihad that was active in jihad against Israel. They conducted a terrorist attack where one employee at the border was killed. And on the right is another sub-organization of the world jihad that is active in Syria. In general, when we talk about to summarize what I've talked about so far, we can say that the probability of deterioration is increasing. The Middle East is very volatile. There are multiple conflicts going on in parallel. There's the stability of the Middle East and Iran and Egypt, and we are going in the direction of deterioration. The attack, the rockets in the Golan Heights, and the tank in Kerem Shalom from Egypt, these are all examples of the deterioration that can be characteristic of the coming months. When I refer to the increase in the influence of the public and the attentiveness of the leadership to the people, which affects the length of the military operations, can lead to a change in what we've seen in the past. I would like to mention Joseph Nye said in the 1990s that the secrets, he talked about the secrets that there are answers to. The intelligence can provide answers. The answers are in either a safe or in libraries or in someone's note or in someone's mind, but these are secrets that are difficult to decipher. But the more interesting phenomenon is the amount of mysteries, of open questions that there are no definite answers for. These effects affect policymaking. There are no definite answers to questions such as what will happen in Syria after Bashar, what will the Middle East look like. There is a significant increase in the number of questions of this kind, which affect the way that we conduct our operations. We are developing intelligence research in a similar fashion to the way that we have worked in the past. Our assumption is that there is quite a bit that we do not know. We try to doubt everything that we do know. This is a new approach that tries to help the policymakers think of different potential developments in the present and in the future. We simulate different possibilities in order to train and challenge the intelligence organizations. What will the Middle East look like over the coming years? There are three possibilities that I think that we should consider and that we should prepare for, we should make preparations for over the coming years. The most optimistic possibility is a possibility of stability and democratization, which I think is least likely. We have to be prepared for violence. And if I have to try to project the future, I would say that we will see different components of each of these different possibilities: stability, violence, and stability with Islam, in the hands of Islam. This is about the Middle East in general, and now a few words about the specific countries. The Iranian nuclear plan is advancing despite the unprecedented international pressure. Iran is attempting to obtain nuclear weapons or to reach a stage that is very close to that. They are enriching uranium, and they are making advancements in other directions as well. In 2012, we identified a gap between what the Iranians can do and what they have actually done.
They are
isolated, there are sanctions, there is increasing internal pressure, there is political pressure, political stress, and the threat of attack, and of course the collapse of Syria, which is a significant development in the Islamic world. In Tehran, we see the internal turmoil that the regime is concerned about, but is prepared to handle. The economic impacts are very significant, but it will be interesting to see how it develops over the coming year. There are also many different possibilities. We think that there's the possibility of Iran giving up on its plan, on its nuclear plans, or going full steam ahead towards its plan. All of these options are possible. In Syria, the Syrian regime has...
But the most interesting is the situation of the state and the possibility of chaos and anarchy that we will come to at some time in the next time. The Syrian regime is fighting in the support of Iran and Hezbollah on its survival and is connected to the sense of victory on certain parts מהטריטוריה הסורית והעברת אמצעי לחימה ונכסים ממקומות שנמצאים בסיכון למקומות בטוחים יותר. מנגנוני המדינה הסורים נשחקים ככל שעובר הזמן, החמושים משיגים הישגים, אבל האופוזיציה, ככל שניתן לקרוא לה ככה, עדיין מפולגת, החברה שסועה וגורמי ג'יהאד עולמי מתבססים בסוריה. העימות בסוריה הפך במובנים רבים למאבק אזורי ובינלאומי בין הצירים במזרח התיכון ובין המעצמות, וכולן רוחשות ועוסקות במה שקורה בסוריה, גם בסכסוך הנוכחי, אבל בעיקר בהרבה מאוד מחשבה על איך ייראה היום שאחרי. המפה הזאת מתארת או מנסה לתאר את הבנתנו לגבי המצב בסוריה מבחינה טריטוריאלית, והפרטים פה פחות חשובים, יותר חשובה התמונה הכוללת. כמו שאתם יכולים לראות, יש אזורים שלמים בצפון המדינה, במזרח המדינה, שנמצאים כבר בשליטת החמושים. הפריפריה של הערים הגדולות, גם דמשק, גם חלב, היא פריפריה שמתנהלת בלחימה, חלקה נמצאת בשליטת החמושים, ולחימה מתנהלת גם בחלק מהשכונות, בפרברים של הערים הראשיות. זו מלחמה עקובה מדם, 70,000...
אני רואה את המספרים, ממוצע של בערך 1,000 עובדים בשבוע, שרואה את הסטטיסטיקה בשנה
האחרונה. מיליון פליטים, יכול להיות שהמספר גם יותר.
אחד המאפיינים של התקופה האחרונה היא שימוש גובר של המשטר בטילי קרקע-קרקע, ברקטות וגם בנשק כימי. יש שימוש נרחב במערך האש הסורי, ירי של מאות טילים ורקטות, אפילו יותר מזה. למיטב הבנתנו המקצועית, המשטר עשה שימוש בחלך ממית נגד החמושים בשורה של אירועים בחודשים האחרונים, כולל האירוע היחסית יותר מפורסם ב-19 במרץ. האישונים המוקטנים, הקצף שיוצא מהפה, הסימנים הנוספים מעידים בראייתנו על כך שנעשה שימוש בנשק כימי ממית. איזה נשק כימי ממית? כנראה סרין, בנוסף לשימוש שהמשטר עושה בנשק כימי
מהסוג המנטרל לא הממית, אבל
התמונה הזאת מגיעה
משימוש
this picture is certainly the type of chemical weapons that can kill. There are two phenomena that go on in that are occurring in parallel. On the tank on the right, you might be able to see another tank just beyond it. This tank was recently on the list of the equipment available to Syria, but now you can see what condition it is in. It is the frameworks are falling apart. There is overall erosion as a result of concentrating the forces into smaller areas. But the Syrians are still capable of firing and operating weapons. Here you see an example of the SA-17 as an example of the equipment, the military equipment that the Syrians receive from Russia. In parallel, Hezbollah is trying to take advantage of the situation for their own benefit. They are supplying advanced weapons. In the end, Syria presents different types of challenges to the IDF, different challenges than they presented in the past. The border in the Golan Heights has been quiet for many years, but now there is the possibility of deterioration on the border. There is the risk of chemical weapons crossing the border. It is certainly possible that there will be other events, other incidents of attack against Israel by other organizations that obtain different types of weapons. In Syria, one option is that Assad continues to fight, but as time passes, the possibilities of chaos and anarchy and deterioration become more likely. The possibility of one central of a single central government is still a possibility, but it is eroding as time goes by. In Lebanon, the Syria is facing the first elections without Assad, and Lebanon is without Assad, and Lebanon is afraid, and Hezbollah is afraid that it will take advantage of the instability, which can cause them harm. There's Sheikh Al-Asir, who is in the picture here in the middle, has expressed the pressure which leads Hezbollah to take even greater risks in their conflict with Al-Hassan within the internal region. In the external arena, there was the terrorist attack in Burgas. In the picture on the right, you can see rockets shot in 2011. And in the picture on the left, there's a picture of an unmanned Hezbollah base. And here you can see a significant example of how Hezbollah supports Assad's regime. They are fighting with Assad in order to maintain the regime. They operate their own army as an alternative to the official one, and Hezbollah, as I've said, is working with the Syrian regime to fight against the armed forces. Hezbollah has increased their supply of rockets and missiles. They have hundreds of long-distance rockets and thousands of missiles that can attack, that can reach a mid-range. Today we are dealing with two different entities, whether geographically, ideologically, and religion, the disputes between Fatah and Hamas will not disappear. In Gaza, the historical process of establishing the Hamas regime is continuing with the assistance of Egyptian organizations. In Gaza, we see it is often quiet. The quiet is sometimes disrupted by militant organizations. We can see the outcome of the Pillar of Defense operation. This is the picture here shows members of the Hamas examining the damage during the operation. Their equipment was severely hit, destroyed during the operation, but it has maintained a positive balance in its own opinion, both in the negotiations and the operative achievements that it reached, and its proven ability to attack deep within Israel. The rejoicing that you see here in the picture is genuine. Hamas continues to fight for its dominance and hopes that it will be preserved. The Hamas and GAP together have thousands of short distance rockets and hundreds of mid distance. The threat of terror from Sinai is led by the Islamic Jihad. In 2011, there was an attack on the Israeli border with Sinai. This organization is the most significant organization within the Islamic Jihad that operates in Sinai. The other side, we see a second organization that is also Islamic and operates activity from Sinai. Those were a few words about the regional environment, and I will conclude with a few words about the changing characteristics of war. When we consider the different elements, each having their own approaches, I think that we can anticipate that the assumptions made in the 1990s are still relevant. It is based on the technological advantage of the Israeli military. It is an attempt to bring Israel to a state of fatigue, to extract a very high price. In the conflict, the fire that we see in this picture here is an example of the conflict that I will talk about soon. The effect of the turmoil is... Here we have an example of the armed forces vehicle carrier that is an example of the volatility and the situation in Sinai and in other regions, in other areas, whether near or far, that leads to an increase in the possibility of deterioration. On the other hand, the turmoil empowers the constraints on the opposite side and can have a calming effect on the development of forces on the other side. We see that they now have the ability to fire longer distances. They are better equipped. They're able to shoot more precisely. That is an aspect that Hezbollah talks about often, and their ability to destroy. The second phenomenon is the very challenging characteristic of the new face of the enemy.
The enemy
had a very specific format, units and divisions, military units, but now we're working almost always with a disappearing enemy. It works from underground, from within civilian, from within the civilian population. Here you can see pictures of rockets being fired from the heart of civilian neighborhoods, from within homes and other civilian facilities. A few words about the cyberspace. It is also another war front. It is asymmetric. It is very challenging power.
We have to
be prepared for war on that front as well.
To
summarize, we are in a period of instability and great uncertainty. There's many power struggles. The environment is of volatility and deployment. There is an increase in the probability of deterioration. There are opportunities that we have to be aware of. The weakening of the radical camp is an opportunity, and that is certainly occurring. The international recognition is an opportunity, and the militant characteristics of the Iranian nuclear plan is certainly an advantage.
Thank you very much, Itai. In an exceptional way, the head of the Institute asked me to ask you if he can ask one question. So I'm saying it publicly because now you can't say no. I'm not going to try. Okay. First of all, I would like to thank Itai, who's a brilliant officer. He grew in the Air Force, and surprisingly, he changed his uniform, but we don't hold it against him. The chemical weapons in Syria is worrying the public in Israel. I belong to those who think that the probability for the activation of the nuclear arms is low. This probability is low, and if it's going to be activated, it's not going to hit us very severely. In this matrix of 2-2-2, who's going to use it and on whom? Maybe the current regime as an element of getting out of history towards Israel, or in the struggle between the opposition, what you call the armed troops. This is one side of the matrix, and the other side is that the armed troops are going to do it once they get in control of the chemical weapons, and they can operate it against Assad or against Israel. In this matrix, where do you think that there is a bigger danger, and where do you think that the probability for the activation of nuclear weapons is low? First of all, there are a few givens and a few things that we have to evaluate, of course. The effect is that in Syria there is a huge arsenal of chemical weapons, more than 1,000 tons of substances, thousands of air bombs, and lots of warheads for SSMs. Another given is that the regime has been activating chemical weapons, as far as we can understand it. These are givens. The reaction of the world to this reflects this trend that I've talked about before, about limited influence and the tendency not to get involved, and very severe evidentiary criteria that, according to the lessons learned from 9/11 and from the operation in Iraq. Now, the developments are really bothersome. First of all, the very fact that they have used chemical weapons without any reaction, any appropriate reaction, I would say this is a very worrying development, because it might signal that this is legitimate. And the probability of the presence of nuclear weapons in the hands of people that do not make a profit and loss calculations is also bothersome. How this is going to develop? Well, this is a good question. I don't think that the result, the clear-cut result of this whole turmoil is the activation of nuclear weapons, but I do think that we have to be very bothered by the possibility that chemical weapons are going to get into the hands of less responsible actors because they don't manage the calculations based on profit and less that you can influence. So we have this fear, and we have to look at the reality and the developments in the next few years.